In the last decades of the 19th century and the early years of the 20th, 2.5 million Jews fled their oppressors in Eastern Europe and made their way to the great cities of America. In their meager baggage, along with candlesticks and maybe a goose feather pillow, were traditions they cherished in the old world and favorite recipes to comfort them in the new. Their immigrant neighbors, the Irish, ate corned beef and cabbage, and German Americans looked forward to boiled beef and cabbage or potatoes. For Eastern European Jews, a special treat on special occasions was brisket. Brisket was an economical cut for large families, and it could be stretched into several meals. Leftovers were ground up to stuff knishes, or kreplach, and the gravy became the base for midweek cabbage or potato soup. Everybody's family seems to have a favorite brisket recipe, but what's really important is knowing how to choose the best piece of meat.
What is your favorite cut of meat?
Brisket.
It's brisket. Okay, great.
This brisket, is my favorite.
Sanford Hershkowitz is a meat purveyor in Cleveland Heights, Ohio. The son of a chicken plucker, Sanford worked his way through graduate school delivering meat to restaurants. Although he earned a PhD in clinical psychology, nowadays he spends his time analyzing what makes a brisket good.
Sanford, they call you Mr. Brisket in Cleveland.
That's right.
Will you tell me how to pick a good brisket?
Okay.
And what is a brisket?
What is, all right, a brisket, pretend I'm a steer, all right? Here's a brisket, okay?
Okay? Yeah.
This is where it comes. It's right at the chest area,
okay?
Okay? Now, meat, beef, bilaterally symmetrical. So each steer has
two briskets,
okay? One on each side, two strips. That's the way God made it. So get a brisket. Let's say that you're in the supermarket.
Right.
And hopefully your supermarket is going to sell a large brisket like this. This is the best way to buy the brisket. It's the most economical, and you get the most flavor and dollar value out of it, too. What you want to be able to do is look for marbling in the brisket. Now, you say that this is covered with fat. You want that fat. You don't want it. This has a gorgeous trim. You leave that alone. You don't touch it. Let the butcher do the trimming. But what you want to do is you want to look on the side. And this is a gorgeous example of a choice brisket right here, because as you see that fat in there?
Yeah.
That's marbling.
I see.
And that melts and gives it flavor and tenderness. There's another example here. This one's even better. Take a look at this.
So you want more meat?
You want more. This is good, but this one is even better.
Uh-huh.
This would really pass our grade. So this is what you would take for your brisket to roast,
okay.
Period. That's the choice.
Because you need a little bit of fat in there.
You've
to make
got it to have, if you don't have the fat, forget it. You're not going to have tenderness. You're not going to have any taste. Now, every 2.5 to 3 minutes, some yachna calls me, and she wants to know.
What's a yachna?
A yachna is like a younger yenta. Okay. It's the same thing.
What's a yenta?
A yenta is a busybody.
Okay.
All right. You have a busybody, a yenta, and you take a yenta, you turn her inside out, and you have a yachna.
Okay.
Okay. Now, so what they want, I want a first cut brisket. That's what I want, that, and I don't want no fat. That's what I hear 5-6 times every minute. So, instead of paying $2.99 a pound for this kind of brisket, you're going to get a first cut brisket.
What's the difference between a corned beef and a brisket?
Okay, remember On the Waterfront? Did you ever see the movie On the Waterfront?
I absolutely did.
I could have been a contender. Well, I can't do Marlon Brando. Okay, let's go back to the brisket. Here we have, let's throw this over there, we don't need this. Here we have a whole brisket. This brisket
with the point in the flat.
The point in the flat.
Point
this
the
is
flat.
Raw. This
okay.
is a raw brisket.
Okay.
Okay? You take this brisket and you pickle it. You put spices in it. You
the
put
whole
water.
Brisket.
The whole brisket.
Okay.
And then you let it cure.
Right.
And then you take it and you have a corned beef brisket. It's identical. There is no difference.
Okay.
One is raw, the other is pickled.
Okay, and then what's the difference between a kosher brisket or corned beef and a non-kosher?
One has been koshered, the other
the
has...
The meat itself, right.
The
First
meat,
of all,
the anatomy
slaughtered.
Is the same.
Right.
They have
okay.
been shechted, okay? Right. It's been slaughtered by a shoychet. It opens it up. It's in your book.
Which is a ritual slaughter.
Well, it's in your book. You didn't read
good,
your book?
Good, I did read my book.
Okay,
I'm
you open it up, you.
You
check the lungs, and if the lungs are okay, they take it and they'll triber it. In other words, they take the veins out of this, and then it has to be soaked and salted and washed, and then it's kosher.
And then it's kosher.
And then
okay.
it's kosher.
And then they can do... Either make it as a brisket.
You can make it as a
the,
after it's been kosher. Right, you make it. You can either use it for corned beef or for a raw
okay,
brisket.
Great. Now, what's your favorite way of cooking brisket?
I never thought you'd ask me that. All right, listen to my recipe. You take
okay.
one envelope of Lipton onion soup mix, one bottle of Heinz chili sauce, and one 12-ounce can of Coca-Cola or RC Cola. Usually Coca-Cola because that's kosher. You take the Coca-Cola, the Lipton onion soup mix, the Heinz chili sauce, you mix it together. Don't taste it because that's awful tasting stuff. You take it, mix it together, dump it on top of the brisket, roast it for three and a half hours. Check the doneness.
Covered or uncovered?
Always covered.
Okay.
At 325. Check for doneness. When it's done, separate the brisket from the... You're going to have a huge amount of this wonderful gravy now. You take it, you get the gravy cold, you get the brisket cold, okay? You take the gravy, it has a huge piece of fat on it because it's cold. You take it, you throw it away. Remember, physics, fat comes to the top, right? Then you have the brisket. You separate the point from the flat, you slice it, you take the brisket, you put it in a roasting pan after it's been sliced cold and defatted. You take that wonderful gravy, you pour the gravy on top of it, cover it, reheat it at 350. For an hour.
Not 325.
Not 325, 350. Then you have a brisket.
What does the Coca-Cola do?
I don't know.
Well, there's a sweetness. Is it
yeah, of course.
Caramelized?
Yeah, I
what?
Guess. I don't Who knows?
It
I
just
don't
tastes.
This is, no, this is not rocket science. You just throw it in, eat it. That's all.
Okay.
It's simple.
Eli Evans, the author of The Provincials, A Personal History of Jews in the American South, was born and raised in Durham, North Carolina, where he learned about Jewish food from Zola Hargraves, his family's cook.
Well, my mother never walked in the kitchen. She was a great manager. She had a business to run.
Mm-hmm.
And she taught our cook to cook all the Jewish food for mm-hmm. Friday nights and everything. In fact, from her point of view, around the black neighborhoods in town, once you had this skill, you were hired by Jewish families forever. It was like a professional skill. So she could do a Friday night meal, and she could do a holiday meal. And she was the one, mother told her how to fix the Atlanta brisket, and she was the one that I first heard it from and never knew what it meant for years until I went to New York.
Tell me about Atlanta brisket. What is it?
Well, Atlanta brisket. You know, Atlanta is one of those communities. Here's a Jewish community, which in 1973, when I first wrote about it, had 16,000 Jews in three or four congregations. It now has 80,000 Jews in 27. It's the fastest growing Jewish community in America. So. What does that mean? It means everybody has a relative there, everybody has a friend there, everybody knows somebody there, and the recipes get passed around. This was a recipe passed down to my mother from my grandmother, and I hesitate to even say what the secret is, but you do baste the brisket overnight, and by using a famous Atlanta elixir, an erotic liquid, you add so much extra taste to it, and the secret of it is Coca-Cola.
<That's great.
laughs> Coca-Cola is the thing that shaped the spires of the churches and the universities. If you want to experience it, I remember when I first came to New York, my mother thought that I was coming to barren canyons to eat Yankee food, and every time I would go home, she would have Zola fix a brisket, and then she would wrap it up in gravy and put it in the freezer, and I would have this cold wad of brisket to take back. And I would even fix it for dates, you know, and I would have Northern girls in, and I would have a brisket dinner with frozen lima beans or something. And then I would tell them, they would say, such a gourmet cook you are, you know. But when I would tell them what the secret of it was, Coca-Cola, they would just howl with laughter and tease me the rest of my life. So if you use this recipe, don't tell anybody. Coca-Cola is not that popular as a marinade.
An onion soup mix.
Onion soup mix and the whole, you know, you brown it first and keep it covered and all of that. It's great.
Jim Cohen is the executive chef of the Phoenician Resort in Scottsdale, Arizona. Jim first made his reputation, and some mistakes, as head chef at the Lodge in Vail, Colorado.
I started doing this because in Vail, I had good customers who wanted me to do Passover, the
uh-huh.
Seder dinner for them.
Right.
And it was a complete disaster because I cooked a brisket, and I cooked it for 2 days. Right. And it never got tender. And I made matzo balls for 300 people, and I threw everything in a mixer, a big Hobart mixer.
Yeah.
And I mixed it for hours. Mm-hmm. And so you could have used these things for golf balls because they were hard as rocks because I didn't know what I was doing. And that's really when I started talking to my mother and saying, why don't I know how to do any of these dishes? You know, the dishes that I grew up with at holidays.
Right.
And so that started the exploration into Jewish cuisine.
Right.
And since then, I've, you know, gone to Italy and explored some of the Sephardic cuisines there, and also just through reading and looking at the flavors on the Sephardic end, along with trying to gather recipes from my aunts and mother. And this, the Sephardic, really comes from my mother-in-law. We started it as a pot roast for Rosh Hashanah.
Oh, so tell me about it.
Well, it started flanken, again, the flanken question. We used a chuck roast to start with it, and then back then the recipes evolved a little bit since we first started. But it's got the Sephardic flavors, the hot sauce, the chilies, the oranges, the cinnamon, and then the dried fruits, the prunes, and the apricots.
So it's sort of Moroccan.
It's sort of Moroccan and ginger, fresh ginger. And I've added pasilla chilies to it, make it a little bit southwestern now that I'm
in Scottsdale connection,
And but it's, and now we're doing it with brisket. For years I did it with short ribs. Joan, I got my pan nice and hot. I'm going to add some great olive oil to it.
Good.
Not schmaltz, but olive oil.
What did you add growing up?
You know, I think my mother used a lot of corn oil. She didn't use a lot of schmaltz.
Very American.
Right, very American.
Buffalo. Okay.
But I definitely use a lot of olive oil, though now I render my own chicken fat.
Really?
And use it, especially with latkes.
Tell me how you do it.
How I do it?
Yeah.
Render it?
Yeah.
I take the skins, put it into a pot, a little bit of water, and I just cook it slowly out until, you know, you got all the moisture out of it. You get the gribbiness, which is the
crunchy,
you know, the crunchy skin cracklings.
My grandfather used to eat, like, potato chips.
Now, my aunt says you got to have onion in it when you make
more
schmaltz.
Flavor, yeah.
Right, but I say, why, if you want onion, you put onion in the recipes.
In the rest, right.
She's cantankerous.
Your aunt.
My aunt.
Okay.
Okay,
here we go.
So now we've got the brisket, it's nice and floured, and we're just gonna sear it up. I always start fat side down.
Absolutely.
Get the flavors.
And now, why do you do this? A lot of people don't like to, they just put their brisket in. Why do you do this?
Seals in the flavors,
okay.
And also adds flavor, the caramelization of the meat. And so while it's cooking, those flavors from the caramelization, again, are getting into the sauce and adds a lot to the sauce.
I gotcha.
How's that for theory?
I think that's it's the best explanation I've heard in a long time, Jim.
We're going to do it even more in our braising technique by not covering the meat, by letting it rise above the sauce and using a hotter oven. We're going to establish more caramelization as this in the whole cooking process.
How long did you say you cook it?
Well, it depends. You know, briskets are very tricky things. I cooked one brisket for 2 days and got nowhere. So I just cook it till it's very, very tender, almost falling apart. That's how I like
and you
it.
So you keep checking.
Right, I keep checking. That's a nice golden color there. See that?
Yeah, that looks beautiful.
It's not real brown or dark. Because you're going to, again, in the braising, you're going to get more color that way.
Do you ever do this like a day in advance? Then you can refrigerate it and get rid of the fat. It's
always.
Easier.
It's really, you know, brisket's always, in my house, you know, the next day is when I love the brisket.
Me
because
too.
And then with horseradish and a sandwich, cold,
that's
or
great.
You warm it up, that's when it's the greatest. So especially in restaurant work, you know, we'll do it ahead and let it set and then clean everything up. So, and it's much better that way. It's better the second day. But what my mother would do is cook it on one day, then she'd slice it and reheat it in the sauce so all the sauce would just, you know, get drunk up by the meat.
Mm.
So now we've seared this up, right? It's got some nice color to it. It's not overdone.
Okay.
Put that on the plate. Then we're going to take our onions.
Saute them
or sweat them. And again, on this, you know, a lot of recipes you read, just sweat, don't add color. But if you get a little color in these, no big deal.
by caramelizing just a little bit with the onions, you get a different flavor to it than you would if you just threw everything in the sauce, and threw it into the oven. I like to get things started and bring the flavors out.
Absolutely.
Now this will be the best, is adding our 2 tablespoons of ginger. You want to do it? Just mix it all up in there. Now the pasillas, and we'll toast those a little bit in there.
Now, what if you can't get pasillas? Can you use another?
You know, use a New Mexico dried chili, a nice, just don't get any of the smoked ones. That'll change
the flavor.
Right. An ancho works fine. I think most grocery stores now you can find dried, some sort of dried chili that'll work.
So I could use ancho or, okay.
Then I'm gonna throw my bay leaf in and cinnamon. Just like that, and I just, you know, this whole idea of toasting spices a little bit, but we do that just a little bit.
Just a
few peppercorns. Sort of a Middle Eastern Indian.
Oh, I see, and then you'll puree all, will you puree the whole cinnamon stick?
I'll get it out of there, and I'll get the bay leaf and the cinnamon stick.
But not the peppers.
Not the peppers.
Then I got
pureed. Then a little bit of hot sauce, and again, it's for your kids, so we're just... They don't really stop. Flash your nose there. Get a little bit in there. And then some of that beautiful fresh squeezed orange juice.
That is good.
And you want to get all the fond off the bottom of the pan. That's where all the flavors are.
Oh, absolutely. This way, my mother always made. I make gravy this way too, but I always think about my mother.
Right.
She takes. She adds a little water to when she's making a roast, and then
pan juices. Now we don't use roux that much. We just let everything naturally.
Right.
Or puree with the blenders. You know, all the vegetables is what thickens your sauces. And then we're gonna get this back.
That fork there.
And I'm going to put it fat side down to start with, but you're going to flip it all through the process.
And that's really an important thing to do, right?
Right. And then water or chicken stock or a mixture of water and beef stock. I wouldn't go all chicken stock. And we'll get a little bit more water, and we'll cover it till about here. Okay, so we've added some of the waters, and you can smell the chili aroma coming up.
I can feel the chili.
Everybody's feeling it. And then I like to add a little bit of the chili liquid, so we strain that out. Get some more of that, more depth of flavor, the beautiful chilies. And then some more water to almost cover.
That's some more?
That's beautiful. I think we'll leave it like that. And then we're going to go into the oven with that. And we're going to keep turning it, keep turning it, keep turning it, until it practically falls apart.
Oh, this looks great.
So here it is out of the oven.
Yeah.
Okay, we've got it all out. And then we're going to take that out, because really one of the tricks to brisket is how you slice it.
You got it. You're going to show me how?
I'm going to show you how. I'm sure you know how.
Well,
so we're going to take this out.
Uh-huh.
Right?
Yeah.
Beautiful. And notice the grains running this way.
Right.
That's very important when you're looking. Then I'm going to move this. And we're going to put all this into a blender. We're going to remove the cinnamon stick and the bay leaf.
Yes.
And then we're going to throw everything into a blender.
Okay.
And puree it all. Okay, so here the grain is running this way.
Right.
Right? And that's very important. And on a brisket, it changes. When you get to the cap, it'll start running both ways. So you have to make a decision which way you want it, or you can separate the cap. I really like to leave the cap on and have some meat running one way and the other way. It's probably because that's how I grew up.
But basically, you have to do it against the grain.
Against the grain.
But and why?
But watch, see how this is, it just, I'm not even putting my, it just falls apart.
Looks great.
See how tender?
But
because it'll be tough and stringy.
When you do it, that's exactly what
happens. Right. You see, if you cut it like this.
Then it's stringy.
Then it'll see just the it'll just be stringy like that.
Can I just taste the difference? I want to just taste it.
Let me cut some of this up.
You're absolutely right. And it's, but you know, what you just said is really something very perceptive, because at the, there is a point where it goes both ways and you don't know what to do and you're a little perplexed. So start where it's clear, right?
It was a dilemma for my father. He was a civil engineer, mm-hmm. but he loved the fat piece in mm-hmm. here because it's got great flavor. So he was a very orderly in how he did everything. So having the cap was always a dilemma for him. But he always elected. He elected to keep it on.
And notice how thin you're doing it too, but not too too thin. When it's too thin, then
right.
it's,
then you're not getting
no
the flavor. We agree on this.
Right. But this is really one of the, I think one of the most important parts of a brisket is knowing how to cut it.
It is definitely.
Well, here's a really great
That's
example.
That's a great shot. But we're lucky on this one. The cap really is sort of not. Sometimes it'll be running completely the opposite way, the grain.
Good New York brisket, right?
Right.
Okay.
So I'm going to take this piece, and that's tomorrow's lunch with horseradish.
Mmm, yum, yum, yum.
On great rye bread. Right?
Okay.
Then we're going to take our platter here.
Mm-hmm.
And I just like to arrange the meat. This is some beautiful, simple couscous. Doing anything fancy here? I'm going to put that around.
Can't wait to eat this one. Looks great. And of course, now, what could you use besides couscous?
Yeah, I've done it. It's great with boiled potatoes. I've done it with the kugels. Just some straight noodles, lakshin.
Mm-hmm. What about like saffron rice or?
You could do a saffron rice.
Mashed potatoes, could you do that?
Yeah, it'd be great with mashed potatoes.
Okay.
But we're moving to lighter things.
Right.
Couscous. And then I'm going to take those apricots.
And how long did you put
about
them in
a half an hour.
Tea water?
Right. And we're just going to garnish. And when people take some of the couscous, it's really great with the couscous, the dried fruits.
Looks wonderful.
One more thing.
Okay.
We're going to take that sauce that we pureed and just take a ladle, right? And then you're just going to pour that over, and it'll get soaked up by the couscous. You'll have all these flavors into the couscous and on the meat. And then I like to serve a little bit on the side in a gravy boat.
Looks
you know,
good.
That wonderful gravy boat my mother had.
My mother still has it.
Right. And there you have it.
Looks wonderful.
Yeah. Good, let's try.
Let us try some of it. It looks delicious. Or just use our fingers.
Fingers. At my house, we always stood around the counter and picked.
Like the day?
Before it got to the dinner table.
You get what we still do. What's your favorite way to cook brisket?
Roast it in the oven.
With
onions.
Lots of onions.
Yeah. Garlic, don't forget.
Of course.
And celery. Whatever flavor you like. But a lot of onions, a lot of garlic, and a little bit of water, very little. And then cover it up for 2.5-3 hours, you've got something.
To learn more about Jewish cooking in America with Joan Nathan, visit us online at www.pbs.org. Companion products for Jewish cooking in America, including Joan Nathan's updated cookbook, a CD of the music score, and a 2-hour video of series highlights and recipes, are available by calling 1-800-235-3000. Credit cards are accepted. Jewish Cooking in America with Joan Nathan is made possible by the Joseph S. and Diane H. Steinberg Charitable Trust, proud supporters of the arts, children's causes, and the preservation of Jewish heritage. And by Hebrew National, proud sponsors of Jewish Cooking in America, serving you and your family traditional kosher franks and delicatessen products since 1905. Hebrew National, we answer to a higher authority.
And by Lender's Bagels. Our idea of a perfect day is warm and comforting and satisfying all around. Lender's Bagels. The perfect circle.
And by the following private individuals and family foundations. This has been a co-production of Joan Nathan, Frappe Productions, and Maryland Public Television.
This is PBS.